take some of the body and chassis next and then bring it together with the dynamics. So the backbone or spine of the entire vehicle, the multi-material space frame. Each material is selected for the particular design challenge. So we went over the A-pillar, and we're gonna go over something we call an ablation casting. But this slide is meant to talk about global torsional rigidity, the ability of what's happening at the front axle to connect to what's happening at the rear axle. And so here, three times the order of the competitors for dynamic torsional stiffness, and two times the order for static. And all of this technology is in-house, so this this is created in-house and with the amazing integrity and accuracy at the Performance Manufacturing Center. So next, we're gonna go a little bit deeper and talk about local rigidity. So here we're talking about each and every point that the suspension attaches to is a precision machine casting. And then those castings are supported by aluminum extrusions in all three directions. So we set up a truss structure. And then furthermore, there's really a lot of hidden optimization in this vehicle. If you look at the aluminum extrusion, it's not only a custom size, but each of the extrusions is optimized. So each of the four walls will have a different thickness. And now bringing to the side view and trying to really emphasize this new technology to keep a compact footprint, to keep that rigid, precise attachment to the suspension, but allow us to manage the collision performance. So we've introduced castings into the crush zones of the vehicle. The rear casting has to support the tremendously high rear impact loads. And the front casting is in the crush zone and actually deformed. So how do you make a casting deform? You create world's first technology, a casting that has the properties of a forging. We call this ablation casting. And this is made at our ANA engine plant. And some people refer to them as liquid metal castings, because you're literally cooling the casting. This is a little sneak peek. You may have seen this on some of our other presentations. We have this tremendous high fidelity computer aided engineering of the body, but also we're some of the leaders in real time high fidelity rendering. So we use these, pay attention to the integrity of the cabin. This is a front flat. You can see the A pillars supporting and maintaining. Now we'll strip away the body panels, show you the deformation in the castings, maintaining the integrity again of the A pillar, as well as the motor room. And just repeating that on an offset. Again, integrity of the cabin, the casting actually deforming, maintaining, again, it hasn't lost its structural integrity, protecting the cabin as well as the front motor room. So a lot of thought and a lot of deep value in how we've arranged the underlying body structure. And finally, on the body structure is the body sealing. So we do seal the cabin at a whole class above our competitors, and that allows you, when you choose, to introduce the intake sound and the exhaust sound without competing sounds. So it's an issue of fidelity and a wide range of performance. So I'm going to move on to the chassis. You know, starting with your hands on the steering wheel, those are connected to a variable ratio gearbox. This is totally mechanical, no electronics here. But the ratio gets quicker as you go off center. So we really feel that once out of the parking lot, you really eliminate all hand over hand motion. So hopefully you weren't shuffling your hands on the track today. That gearbox is rigidly mounted to the chassis, controlling the all aluminum double wishbone front suspension. The lower wishbone is split into two. We do that to control the wheel center. So we minimize the wheel center offset, a little bit techy, but essentially, each wheel could have an independent motor torque, and it doesn't create a lateral force into the gearbox, which will really disturb or give you kickback. Also, out on the real roads, it really allows us to have good compliance in the front suspension, again, without creating disturbances back from the road through the steering, so that, together with the amazing torsional rigidity, you can have natural steering feel. The rear suspension is all about high lateral rigidity, purely lateral, but also aligning torque. And so here we're able to get this front and rear suspension moving together. So again, your inputs at the front faithfully move the entire center of gravity. So I hope you felt the front and the rear of the vehicle very connected today on the track, you know, as you were searching for the apex, as you were turning in or as you were accelerating out. All four corners have the third generation magnetic rheological fluid damper, MRF damper. This is our Acura active damping system. So the key here is the widest range of damping force combined with the quickest response. And we use this, again, to essentially create very fluid motion in terms of the unsprung mass. So keep this in your mind as you head out, really trying to not disturb the tires, pull them off the ground or compress them, changing the tire footprint. But at the same time, it's not about ride comfort, but we're trying to stabilize you in the seat. So we're not necessarily trying to minimize body roll or pitch angle, but if you're stable in the seat with no extraneous motions, you can have that much more fidelity in terms of your steering. If the inertia of your body in the seat actually causes stress on your brain and unwanted steering inputs. So if you just keep that intention in your mind as you're evaluating the product. So bringing this all together, on the horizontal axis is vehicle speed from 0 to over 190 miles an hour, and vertical axis is the yaw rate gain, or the basic vehicle response. And so at low speed, absolutely the best agility. This means the least amount of your workload. You can really relax and faithfully achieve the cornering attitude. And at high speed, really, we actually bend the curve over, achieving very high-speed, stable feel. So it's very relaxed cruising at 190 miles per hour, and that is not the norm yet in this segment. Just touch on brakes a little bit. We do use an electro-servo brake. The reason we do that, if you pay attention to the graph to the right, we actually have the ability to recover energy from the front two independent motors. So as every time you braked, you were recovering energy, keeping the state of the charge of the battery high. The trick here, it's kind of cool to think about as you're driving, is that your next action is not using that energy. So whether it be directly creating a yaw moment as you turn down or accelerate, you're now using up that energy you just recovered. In the lower portion of the left side, you see the tandem motor cylinder. Essentially, we have a very precise and adaptable way to seamlessly integrate motor brake force with the hydraulic force that we demand of the powerful Brembo brakes. So this circuit on the lower left is generating hydraulic power to the Brembo brakes and mixing it with what we're regenerating from the motors. Again, I hope it feels invisible to you. Across the ribbon, from the hot glowing red brakes, your supercar demands. We do have this precise adaptable pressure map. We have really well thought out brake cooling and the balance between the front and the rear, and very powerful Brembo brakes. So the graph to the right is all about the man-machine interface. And so whether you're just scrubbing some speed at low decel, or whether you're full on at 0.8, 0.9 decel on the track. The pedal stroke to pedal force, if you look underneath that red line, there's a little triangle drawn in there. The area of that triangle we seek to make consistent, so that you as a driver, it's the same amount of work, but it transitions from stroke to force. So please continue to have an open mind towards our very challenging approach towards braking the vehicle, and definitely want to hear your opinions as we challenge to make a very consistent, powerful, natural feel in spite of the fact of having high technology. So on the track, we know we have the best fade performance of all of our competitors. And it's not just because of the electro-servo brakes, but the trick is the brake cooling and how we balance that front to rear. We also know that out on your favorite winding road, the consistency of our input-output is really good, and in cities, you really don't have too much bite or a real touchy pedal. So it's sophisticated, but we think it has a real world benefit. So we're coming towards the end. So here we're going to talk a little bit about torque vectoring. Back in the day, Honda and Acura have been at this for over 25 years, my entire career. We originally called it active torque transfer system. And so it's really trying to proactively support the driver. No matter how much we seek to make the chassis rigid, there's a certain amount of compliance. And as a human being, we can take advantage of your high fidelity electric control unit up here by linearizing those motions. So on the left, mechanical super handling all wheel drive. And we're introducing a new term here, direct yaw control. In this case, with our mechanical system, we're splitting your existing driveline torque. So give me a driveline torque and I can split it. So this is most effective when you're accelerating and turning. So now, evolving that to this latest generation, sport hybrid direct yaw control. So here, you've got a separate lithium ion battery directly energizing independent motors. Therefore, I can support you 100% of the time. So there's no control here, there's no intervention, it's just responding to your steering inputs. So it's that simple, and hopefully, you can feel it, not just at the track, but hopefully it'll be even more helpful on the road. That was our intention. So here is a video, and then there's going to be some screens that pop down the right-hand side. And here we're focused on the independent twin motor unit in the front. So you're accelerating into the corner, two red arrows shooting forward. You want to accelerate. But then you quickly transition to braking. You're recovering energy, and if you're trail braking, while you're recovering energy, you're still splitting the torque left to right. So this is supportive behavior just for your braking while cornering. And then here, you're transitioning from a clockwise right turn, a slight inward motion from the dotted geometrical center, and then you're going to transition back to the left, and perhaps you are transitioning from braking to now acceleration. So again, while accelerating, we can support that actively, but we still maintain this inward moment, this supportive of your steer. And then we've got one more slide where we did the anatomy of the corner. And I'm not going to go into great detail, it's out there, but there's a couple other systems that work together. Again, number one we've talked about, but number two, not only the twin motor unit in the front, but the agile handling assist. So we do have brake-based torque vectoring at the rear axle. This is just at the transient turning. But think about the front independent motors and the brake just as you turn in, working in concert. So as you rotate the dial from quiet to sport plus to track, those are working together and ramping up that ability. Number three, you're at the apex and you're now back to the throttle. So here the twin motor unit and the mechanical LSD on the rear axle, again, working together. And number four, I think, is honestly one of the sweet spots of this car, is as you're accelerating out of the corner with a slightly diagonal attitude. And then hopefully you felt as we were shifting, not only are the shifts very fast, but through the shift, the front motors are pulling you through the shift. So the image we had in our mind, that single pop from the exhaust, it's much more like a motorcycle. So if you're on a motorcycle, you do not want to disturb your tire contact patch. And so this idea of continuous flowing forward momentum, and so super simple, if you're going to simplify it, number one is about getting your eyes to the apex better than the competitors. Number two is about going back to the throttle earlier without a sense of over-rotation. And so again, on behalf of the driver, allowing them to have a diagonal acceleration and turn in at track exit. This is highly overly simplified. And